30 years after Peter Ellis was accused of child sex abuse at the Christchurch Civic Creche, he's been completely exonerated. This long-running case made New Zealand legal history when his appeal was allowed to continue after his death in 2019. Throughout his trial, seven-year imprisonment and legal battles, Peter Ellis always maintained his innocence. Today, the Supreme Court found there had been a substantial miscarriage of justice. The court found the evidence given by a specialist psychiatrist at the 1993 trial exceeded the proper bounds of an expert witness, and her evidence lacked balance. On the question of whether complainant evidence was contaminated, the court found the jury was not fully informed of the level of risk. The court concluded the care and attention needed for a case of such unprecedented complexity was underestimated at the time of the investigation and trial. In our coverage tonight, we hear from Peter Ellis. He spoke exclusively with John Campbell just days before his death. But first, Kushla Norman on the legal decision that's ended one of the most controversial cases in New Zealand history.
In life, Peter Ellis was branded a paedophile, convicted of abusing seven children with sordid claims including satanic rituals. But in death, he's a man exonerated.
The appeal is allowed. The convictions of the appellant are quashed.
The Ellis family was at court today with one glaring absence, the man it's all about.
Wish my brother was here, because it was really what he deserved. Not for us to hear so much. We're just so proud of him.
Yep.
Proud of the person he was. Damn.
Relief for the family, but shock for the parents of the child complainants. In a statement, they said they believe the court has favoured a convicted criminal and ignored the victims. The children have not been allowed a voice in this process, and that some are still too afraid and traumatised.
This has been an extraordinary case. Appeals by the dead aren't normally allowed, but today the court told us why this one was, saying a long-standing concern over a possible miscarriage of justice meant it was in the public interest for it to go ahead.
The crux of the appeal was that improper interview techniques were used with the children, leading to unreliable testimony and unsafe convictions. Experts beamed in with evidence.
The number and combination of contamination opportunities in this case far exceed anything that has been or ever will be studied in a laboratory.
Looking back, the judges found big problems with the evidence given by a psychiatrist. Dr. Karen Zellis rose to prominence during the case.
It's most important that parents don't, in fact, question their children on the possible events that may have occurred.
As a Crown witness, she told the 1993 jury there were 20 behaviours consistent with sexual abuse. But the Supreme Court said the evidence lacked balance and had the overall effect of suggesting clusters of behaviour supported a finding of sexual abuse.
It would be nice if she acknowledged that she'd got it wrong. It would certainly help all the people, all the poor complainants who, as a result of her evidence, were left with this belief that all their misery was caused by Peter Ellis.
Her book highlighted the moral panic in early 90s Christchurch.
So it's taken 30 years to get this right. Was Peter a victim of the times?
Oh, I think so, very much, for a number of reasons.
An extraordinary legal saga now over and a man's mana restored.
Well, Kushla Norman joins me now live. Kushla, if Peter Ellis was alive today and just won a legal victory, we'd be talking about compensation. What's the situation with that?
We would, and that's a great question, Miriama. We're in uncharted territory once again with this extraordinary case. It just seems to keep breaking new legal ground. Now, Cabinet, they decide whether or not compensation should be given in a miscarriage of justice. But as it currently stands, the Cabinet manual doesn't allow for posthumous compensation. Now, the Justice Minister, Kitty Allen, she's looking into this and seeking advice on whether it should be changed. But even if it was changed, there would have to be an application from the Ellis family. I asked them if they're interested in pursuing compensation. They said that's not never been important to them. And what was driving them all along was clearing Peter Ellis's name.
Thanks for that, Kushla. Live from Wellington there. Well, as we've heard, today's ruling closes one of the most contentious and longest-running legal sagas in New Zealand history. Looking back now, in 1991, a police investigation starts after complaints at the Christchurch Civic Creche. Five staff, including Peter Ellis, were charged in 1992. But early the next year, charges against four female workers are dropped. Ellis goes on trial that year and is convicted of sexually abusing seven children and is sentenced to 10 years imprisonment. His first appeal is dismissed in 1994, but the court quashes three convictions after a child described as the most credible complainant retracts allegations, saying she made it up. A second appeal fails 5 years later. The Court of Appeal not convinced a miscarriage of justice has taken place. Ellis is released from prison in February 2000. A month later, a ministerial inquiry finds there were no doubts about the reliability of children's evidence. The next year, the book, A City Possessed by Lindley Hood, prompts a petition by well-known New Zealanders, but their call for a Royal Commission of Inquiry is rejected. In July 2019, Ellis is granted leave to appeal to the Supreme Court, but he dies 2 months later from cancer. The next year, the Supreme Court allows a posthumous appeal to go ahead. That hearing on the reliability of the children's evidence and whether it was improperly obtained begins. And today, the Supreme Court decision, Peter Ellis's convictions are quashed. Now, in July 2019, Peter Ellis received a terminal cancer diagnosis. In the days before his death, in September of that year, he invited John Campbell for the Sunday program into the hospice to talk about the case and how his life had unfolded since. A warning now, some viewers may find the interview confronting. It's never been aired before. It shows a man who is dying, he's on medication, he's being made comfortable. It's a conversation with a man who desperately wants justice and fears he's going to die before getting it.
Yeah. Righto, when do we start?
Let's start now. Right. How are you?
How am I? I'm not doing too bad at the moment. Currently where I'm living is wonderful, and they look after me well, and it's about the best we can go with at the moment.
This was Friday the 30th of August 2019. Peter Ellis died the following Wednesday.
These were Peter Ellis's last moments of freedom before being convicted and jailed for 10 years in June last year.
That June was 1993, 29 years ago, and it all began 2 years before that.
Since 1991, I've battled to clear my name.
We knew he had terminal cancer, but we had no idea how very ill he was until we arrived. He was in palliative care, living on morphine and fizzy drinks, surrounded by his treasures, by gifts, by cuddly toys, by Marilyn, by the accumulation of a life that was ending and had been crushed by what he would never hear the Supreme Court call a substantial miscarriage of justice.
I've always laughed my way through things, so it's part of what happened to me, I suppose. I could laugh my way through it.
It's not funny, though, is it?
No, it's not funny.
This case, at the end of this case, I had no doubt that Peter Ellis was innocent, and I was his lawyer.
No doubt, for three decades, since he looked like this, Rob Harrison has always sworn he would never let it rest.
Why not?
Because it's wrong. All right, the conviction of Peter is wrong.
You talked about being innocent.
Mm-hmm.
And used that word.
Yep.
And I just want to ask you, are you innocent? Did you do any of these things?
No, I've never done any of these things, and yes, I am innocent.
A reminder again of what the Supreme Court said. We have concluded that a miscarriage of justice has occurred, and accordingly, we allow the appeal and quash the appellant's convictions.
There aren't many things more terrible than being accused of child sex abuse.
No, it's not.
Were there ever times that you worried you would succumb to a kind of despair?
No, never once.
Rob Harrison may have come close. Blenheim based now, he's carried the trial losses with him for three decades. How could such a miscarriage of justice occur? And he worries that with homosexual law reform having only happened in 1986, part of it may have been that Peter was gay.
Up until then, someone like Peter, their life was an aberration. They could be prosecuted, could they be dragged before the courts, they could be imprisoned for their behaviour. So inherently, there is a particular bias, even in the 90s.
Against gay men?
Against gay men. I think there's got to be a part of that. No one's ever said that, but I think that I think we've got to acknowledge that that may have played a part.
How do you address such things, even after Peter Ellis has died? Well, you never give up, even arguing tikanga in the country's Supreme Court. The body dies, the reputation survives.
In accordance with tikanga, everyone, Māori and Pākehā, including Mr. Ellis and his whānau, has mana. Mana and the importance of seeking to restore and uphold mana is something that transcends death.
I don't want to be a box in a shelf saying, well, he died, bad luck.
He died before his luck changed, but change it did. Peter Ellis, convictions quashed.
On the way down on the plane this morning, I was reading I think it was by Martin Van Beinen, but so much has been written about you, Peter. Mm-hmm. And they said, only Peter really knows.
Mm-hmm.
What is it that you really know?
I really know that I am not guilty of abusing children at the Civic Creche. And that's about all I can say on that. Nothing more, nothing less. It's just straight out, plain and clear.
Well, John Campbell joins me now. Quite an extraordinary case, an extraordinary interview as well. What was it like to sit with him in those final days?
We didn't know how sick he was. Rob Harrison, his lawyer, phoned me and said Peter would love to talk. And I said, okay, I'll come down the next couple of weeks. And he said, you need to come pretty quickly. And he was extraordinarily brave. He was on morphine. He stopped taking it during the interview so he could be sentient, but he was in a lot of pain.
Yeah.
And he was dying. And that was on a Friday. He died the following Wednesday. But he just wanted to say those things one last time. I think he hoped that he might make it against incredible odds to the Supreme Court, but he didn't. And he needed us to hear him say those things. And I think of Rob Harrison, who was Peter's defence lawyer in the first trial in 1993, who 30 years later has achieved this extraordinary result today from the Supreme Court. And the community, Peter became part of a small Christchurch community that just loved him.
Yeah.
And so it's a tragic story, but he had amazing supporters and he was surrounded by love at the end.
He wanted to see justice before he died. He didn't get that. Where does this finding leave all the players?
I don't know, Mitty. I mean, it feels awful. I mean, the Supreme Court saying that this is a substantial miscarriage of justice is a striking blow against everything that has preceded this. So what the hell happened in 1993? I saw Kushler talking about her with you, and I also saw it featuring Kushler's story. And this is the specialist psychiatrist, a woman called Dr. Karen Zealous, who was just all over the prosecution case. I've just been looking at the Supreme Court judgment. She was a Crown witness at the trial. She gave evidence as an expert witness. She also had other roles in the case, including supervising the interviewers who interviewed the complainants and assisting the police during the investigation of the allegations against the appellant. And what the Supreme Court is essentially telling us is there was no room for reasonable doubt. The jury wasn't given the basis to find Peter Ellis not guilty. So what the hell happened in 1993? Rob Harrison, who was an extremely reasonable man, says, actually, we've got to look back at how the prosecution case was conducted, and we've got to say it simply wasn't good enough. We got it wrong. We've heard from the complainants' families who are saying, what the hell has happened here? So no one, Peter Ellis didn't get the chance for justice during his life. So I don't think anyone's satisfied. Mm. And I don't think this is the end of it. It would conventionally be the end of it because Peter's dead and the Supreme Court has ruled. But I think we have to go back to 1993 and say, what happened?
Yeah, and you know, we have to leave it here, but there are so many interesting parts of this entire process, aren't there? Including actually the precedent that tikanga set. But we'll leave it there for now. John Campbell, thank you so much for joining us this evening and for that brilliant interview.
Thank you.
Thanks. Well, for more reaction to the Ellis case, head to our website, onenews.co.nz.